Our testament reading today is found in Psalm 107, verses 1 through 3 and 23 through 32. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord say this, those he redeemed from the hand of the foe, those he gathered from the lands, from east and west, from north and south. Others went out on the sea in ships. They were merchants on the mighty waters. They saw the works of the Lord, his wonderful deeds in the deep. For he spoke and stirred up the tempest. They lifted high the waves. They mounted up to the heavens and went down into the deep, to the depths. In the peril, their courage melted away. They reeled and staggered like drunken men. They were at wit's end. Then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he brought them out of their distress. He stilled the storm to a whisper, and waves of the sea were hushed. They were glad when it grew calm, and he guided them to their desired haven. Let them give thanks to the Lord for his unfailing love and his wonderful deeds for men. Let them exalt him in the assembly of the people and praise him in the council of the elders.
This morning, our gospel lesson comes from Mark 4, 35 to 41. Now let me give you a little background before we look at just these short verses. Earlier on in Mark 4, Jesus is teaching the crowds from a different kind of place. He's not on a hill, but he's in a boat. He's on the water. He shares the parable of the sower, which you all know. And then right before the lesson that we're going to read today, he teaches about the mustard seed. The kingdom of God is like a mustard seed. So his teaching to the crowds has ended for the day, and this is where we pick up our lesson. Mark 4:35. Let us listen to the word of our Lord. That day when evening came, Jesus said to his disciples, "Let us go over to the other side." Leaving the crowd behind, they took him along, just as he was in the boat. There were also other boats with them. A furious squall came up, and the waves broke over the boat so that it was nearly swamped. Jesus was in the stern, sleeping on a cushion. The disciples woke him and said to him, "Teacher, don't you care if we drown?" Jesus got up, rebuked the wind, and said to the waves, "Quiet, be still." Then the wind died down and it was completely calm. He said to the disciples, "Why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith?" They were terrified and asked each other, "Who is this? Even the wind and the waves obey him." May the calm of Jesus prevail for us this morning as we study his words. This gospel lesson, like the one we did last week, is a familiar Bible story. You probably already learned this when you were in Sunday school. But today, we're going to look at it in perhaps a little different way. In this Bible study story, Jesus is usually depicted as the man standing on the boat with his arms outstretched and the waves, the white caps in the pictures. Most often we hear of Jesus doing another miracle. The miracle of calming the sea, of controlling nature, something that only Jesus could do. Indeed, that is part of the lesson. But today, we're going to dig a little bit deeper into this narrative. We know that Jesus was teaching from a boat. I'm glad that they don't make pastors today preach from a boat. I don't think there's enough Dramamine to do that, especially if it were the Sea of Galilee. But back then, it was not unusual for Jesus to teach from the boat. You see, because the crowds were so huge, there wasn't a place that Jesus could stand that everyone could see him or everyone could hear him. So Jesus is in the boat, out a little bit on the water, so that everyone could see him and everyone could hear him. But that day, as we read earlier, had been a full day. Jesus was exhausted, so he tells the disciples as evening comes, who, by the way, were experienced sailors, "Let's move. Let's go to the other side." After giving directions, Jesus assumes the place of honor. You see, there was a seat with a cushion on it, and that cushion he uses to rest his head. Now, what you may not know is that there was only usually one seat that had a cushion, and that was the seat of honor for the person in the boat. So instead of sitting on the cushion, Jesus takes the cushion and lays it down and puts his head on it. And as soon as his head hits the cushion, Jesus is asleep. Now, Jesus could have just told the disciples, "Why don't you just take me ashore so I could rest?" But he changes direction. For you see, the other side of the Sea of Galilee was the country of the Gerasenes. It was Gentile territory. This is perhaps the first time that Jesus heads into dangerous territory. It's the first time that he proclaims that Jesus' mission reaches far beyond just the Jews. Jesus is reaching out to strangers. Jesus is reaching out to those people who have been cut off from the Jewish race. He's reaching out to possibly enemies of the house of Israel. Knowing this, shouldn't we expect something different to happen? Jesus is taking those disciples out of their comfort zone, and he's giving them another lesson. It's scary getting out of your comfort zone, isn't it? But you see, Jesus is traveling with them. He didn't just send them to be on their own. And it works for a short time. The disciples are comfortable with Jesus in their boat. The disciples, they follow Jesus' request without argument. They head to the other side. But soon the sea is no longer friendly. Now, storms on the Sea of Galilee were not uncommon either. Because of its location and because of the geography surrounding it, storms were quite common. They would come up quickly and then they would leave. Obviously, Jesus wasn't worried. I think that if he were worried, he would have warned the disciples. But he didn't warn the disciples. Remember, he took the cushion and he laid down and went to sleep. Perhaps Jesus was thinking, "Don't sweat the small stuff. It's only a storm. We'll get through it." Funny how the others didn't see things the same way that Jesus does. Now let's remember what Jesus was doing before that journey began. He was teaching parables to the crowds. There should have been no doubt in anyone's mind, especially the disciples that were with Jesus, who Jesus really was. But when the winds rage and the waves threaten to swamp their boat, the disciples are no longer sure that they have on board the Son of God. As the scene reaches chaos, they panic and they wake Jesus up. And they aren't nice about it either. They accuse Jesus of not caring about them. "Don't you care that we're going to drown?" they said to Jesus. Fear, anger, lack of faith, don't they all seem to surface when chaos enters our lives? When we have no control. When things don't go as we have planned them, when we find ourselves in uncomfortable places, confronted by challenging circumstances, our foundations begin to tremble if we are not firmly planted in Jesus. Scripture instructs us to call out to Jesus. Remember the psalm that Edna read this morning? The writer of the psalm says it over and over again. It was when they verbalized their fear and their suffering that they were assured of God's presence. It's not until we have articulated our feelings and our anger that's below that we can be still and listen for the word of God. Just a word. That's all it takes. With simple words, Jesus rebukes the wind and the waves. Peace, or be quiet, be still. The wind ceased, and some translations said it was dead calm. Others say it was completely calm, but you know what calm feels like. This is hardly the first or the only time when the power of God's words were embodied in Jesus, and Jesus did great things. God spoke and brought forth all of creation from formless void, and what some theologians refer to in the beginning as chaos, because there was no order. Chaos before God called and spoke things into order. God spoke again, and God's word became flesh in Jesus Christ. God's word called a nation into being and inspired prophets who guided that nation. It's easy to forget that God's all-powerful word is still spoken today amid the noise and the chaos of our lives and in our world today. And like Jesus' word of peace spoken over the raging storm, God's word spoken today still conquers the forces that threaten us, that threaten to do harm, that threaten to leave our lives in chaos. God's word can still still the storms and calm our deepest fears. We say that we know Jesus. We say that we trust Jesus. We say that we rely on Jesus. But when storms rage in our lives and in the world around us, we accuse Jesus of not caring. The disciples said the same thing. But notice that Jesus calmed the seas. It didn't matter that the disciples made accusations or if they showed little faith. Jesus spoke. The sea stopped raging, and my guess is Jesus went back to sleep, mumbling to himself, "Will they ever learn? Will they ever just trust me?" I'm sure nothing has changed today. For in the midst of our chaos, in our storms, we accuse God. "God, don't you care about me? Can't you see that I'm drowning here?" Of course he cares. Of course he sees it all, and he will calm the seas when we call out to him in what little faith we have. In times of trial, in times of fear, we can call out to Jesus even if we feel like we have lost our faith. Jesus is there. God continues to be in control of our world. It's comforting to know that for God, times of calm and times of chaos are just seconds apart. Remember, it's the blink of an eye in God's time, and he surely knows. He surely cares, and God goes with us until the chaos turns back into his calm. May we rest in that assurance that Jesus never fails. Amen. Sometimes I think our lives go from calm to chaos. And when they go from calm to chaos, we're just so out of sorts that we forget that God's in control. Let us go from this place remembering Jesus in the boat, that it just took word from Jesus and he calmed the storms. Let us pray that he calms the storms not only around us, but he calms the storms within us. Let us walk in faith, knowing that Jesus never fails. Amen.